In case you don't know yet, since June 2019, it is legal in Germany to ride so-called e-scooters, aka electric scooters, on the streets. Which is great news for me, because I'm a huge fan of electric vehicles. But everything I built on my own so far has never been legal to ride on the streets. So I immediately started searching for an e-scooter on Amazon. But sadly, all relatively cheap ones were not road legal, and the legal ones started at a price of around 400 to 500 euros, which was a bit too pricey for my taste. Thankfully though, I found a discounter e-scooter from Aldi, which you can also directly order from the Maginon website. It is called the eScooter Street 1, which can drive with speeds of up to 20 km per hour and up to a range of 12 km, at a price of only 279 euro. So, needless to say, I ordered one of those. And in this video, I will not only go for a test ride with it and tell you my personal opinion about it, but I will also try to upgrade some of its, let's say, price-related, not optimal electrical features. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by JLC PCB, who produce high-quality PCBs for a rather low price. I've been using their service for years, and I can surely recommend it. So why not upload your Gerber files today and get your own professionally made PCBs within a week? After receiving the e-scooter, I obviously opened up its box in order to take out the manual with the operating license, a box filled with accessories, and finally the e-scooter itself. At this point though, the scooter was not ready for legal ride on the streets, because I still had to attach the handles, a bell, a front light as well as a front reflector, and finally a backlight. And after then ordering a proper insurance for the scooter, adding the insurance number plate to the back of it, and charging the scooter completely up with the given power supply, it was finally time for the first test ride. So I started my GeoTracker app and basically just drove around with the scooter in my town. To get a good feeling for it, I tried all kinds of different terrains and also how the scooter performs uphill and downhill. And after around 1 hour of driving, the battery was empty and I was able to achieve a travel distance of 12 km at a maximum speed of 18 km per hour. So its most important test results are not that far off its given product description. And while I did enjoy driving this e-scooter, I still have to address some problems. The first one is that while the metal frame of the scooter is truly sturdy and the hinge design is simple and effective, I have to say that some kind of shock absorber would have been nice. If you're driving on small rocks, it might not be such a problem, but as soon as you hit cobbles or something similar, your whole body as well as the scooter will shake. There was even so much shaking that my front light got loose, and I even lost my backlight on the way back. Of course, that is a mechanical problem that I'm not able to fix in this video, but I wanted to tell you anyway, because I think it is rather important. Now, when it comes to electrical upgrades, there are basically four of them which come to mind, which includes the scooter's maximum speed, its range, its required charge-up time, and finally the fact that the front and backlight use their own little batteries. So let's see how much we can improve those problems. That means it was time to remove the lids of the electronics compartment, which required removing a couple of screws and also cutting the warranty seal. Because, as you would expect, my modifications will not only destroy the warranty of the scooter, but also probably its street legal status. But anyway, next I took off the lids, which revealed the battery pack as well as the motor controller. Now I do have to say that the mounting and wiring was very neatly done, But since I need access to pretty much all wires later on, I pretty much had to destroy this nice setup. So, first off, let's talk about the maximum speed, which I measured to be around 18 km per hour, and which dropped over time as the voltage of the battery pack decreased. As you might already have guessed, does the voltage of the battery pack directly determine how fast a BLDC motor can spin, which means by increasing the voltage, we should get a higher speed. But the problem I noticed was that even while going downhill with the scooter, the speed was limited to 18 km per hour, which probably means that the controller limits the motor's RPM according to the German law, and thus the voltage of the utilized battery pack could be enough to already get a higher end speed. To prove this theory, I firstly measured the maximum RPM of the hub motor while using the original electronics, which turned out to be around 3200. Next, I disconnected the motor wires as well as the power wires of the battery and instead hooked them up to this VESC. After configuring the motor through the VESC software and telling the VESC to spin the motor as fast as possible with the power of the battery pack, I measured an RPM of around 3200 as well. That was quite a surprise for me, because that means that the motor is specifically designed to achieve 18 km per hour with the given voltage of the battery pack. And only increasing the supply voltage would lead to a higher speed above 18 km per hour. But since getting a higher voltage battery pack and using a new motor controller would be quite a hassle, I decided to not alter the maximum speed. Next is the range, which turned out to be around 12 km with the given battery pack that comes with an energy of around 158 watt-hours. To, for example, double the range, we would simply need a battery pack with double the energy. But that would of course mean we would require more space in the electronics compartment, which we do not have. So I came up with another plan, for which I used a decent DC jack and a proper switch that can handle a bit of current. What I did was creating two holes in the side of the electronics box, which was easier said than done, and then connecting the battery pack, motor controller and DC jack to the switch according to this wiring diagram. After then using two component adhesive to secure the extra components to the box, my small range extender modification was complete. Now in switch position 1, the built-in battery pack powers everything like usual. But in position 2, you can hook up an external battery pack through the DC input jack. This is useful for me, since I got this spare electric skateboard battery pack laying around for quite a while. By simply adding a wire to it with a suitable plug, I can place it inside a backpack and thus use it to power the scooter in emergency situations. And with that being said, it was time for the charge up time, which according to my stopwatch required around 3 hours and 15 minutes. That is no wonder though, because the battery pack has a capacity of 4.4 amp hours and the power supply can only deliver a maximum constant current of 1.5 amps. By doing a bit of math, we can see that the charging process should take around 3 hours. But can't we just increase the maximum constant current to shorten the charging time? To find that out, I had to open up the battery pack in order to find out that the utilized cells were H18650cc, which can handle a charging current of 2.15 amps. That means since this is a 10S 2P pack, we can charge it with a maximum of 4.3 amps at 42 volts. Such chargers do kind of exist, but if you want to be on the safe side, you can also use a suitable lab bench power supply with current limiting feature. For the last upgrade, I wanted to get rid of the external batteries used by the front and back lights. So I soldered wires to the battery terminals in order to determine how much voltage and current each one requires. With those values in mind, I calculated a suitable resistor network for each lamp and created them in order to hook them up and test whether the lights would function correctly with the high battery voltage, which they did. So I drilled holes in both lamps through which I fed a wire which I soldered to the electronics. Then I drilled additional holes into the frame of the scooter to guide the wires into the electronics compartment. And there I soldered the wires to the resistors and the battery power according to this wiring diagram. And after securing the lamps with a bit of Loctite, my scooter upgrade was pretty much complete. I decided to not increase the speeds, but for everything else I implemented an, in my opinion, decent upgrade. And of course the scooter can still drive without any problems. As always, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video, then don't forget to like, share, subscribe and hitting the notification bell. Stay creative and I will see you next time!